Needle exchange has gone through so many cycles in the United States over the last, I mean, really started in 1988, so 2013 was at 25 years. So in the early days, there were very, very few needle exchange programs for the first few years, and they were all pretty much activist run, all pretty much without significant funding, and all incredibly inventive. And people, because we came to this as activists, we didn't really necessarily have social services type backgrounds. So we would sort of make up how we did things. And you'd see these little, many of the programs had individual identities. Like Santa Cruz New Exchange Program was a youth-oriented program, did lots of amazing zines. CNN actually in Los Angeles was very connected to the music industry, like Red Hot Chili Peppers and Jane's Addiction back in that time period. And they were also a youth program with a very dynamic. We were very much on the Lower East Side. You know, we had a storefront, we did lots of we did poetry nights, we did music things, we had softball games and things like that, and picnics. It's all about, you know, community. It's all about creating a social center, a social nucleus for street drug users. Then we go through periods of change where the activist energy that went into the early days of needle exchange began to dissipate a little bit. We got more mainstream funding, we got some government funding, government-sponsored needle exchange programs came along. And along with that, you get oversight and you get rules and regulations, which I actually totally support, not in terms of restricting what we do, but in giving access of what we do to more and more people. Because when we were small, we weren't reaching the amount of people that we needed to reach. And it becomes a choice. Do you have this boutique thing going on, or do you actually affect, at that point, an HIV epidemic, or affecting, do you change the course of an overdose problem in a neighborhood? And you can't do that if you're reaching 40 people. You've got to reach 4,000. So as you go through these generational shifts, needle exchange programs have got more widespread, they're more integrated. They're still located in this country, on the West Coast, East Coast, Midwest, but virtually none down south, which is a real problem. And then you've still got significant amounts of programs that operate on a shoestring, and they operate underground as well without official permission to actually operate. So we got these well-instituted programs which, have become social service programs for drug injectors. And that, in some ways, is what we were going for. In some ways, we lost some of the creativity. In some ways, we had done our job, because when we started doing this a long time ago, places like New York City and Bridgeport, Connecticut, Baltimore, D.C. were epicenters of injection drug use and HIV in the world, and you can't say that anymore. So, you know, we had these life cycles of programs, and they're still magnificent, magnificent programs. And what we need to do is build these bridgeheads down south in the U.S., and that's where we need to go next.